they are upside down, these revolutionary teachings of the most unique teacher. They are the Beatitudes. How can you explain this? Happy are you if you cry, or happy are you if you are poor? It appears not to make sense. Today, we will take a closer look at the Beatitudes. Let us experience the Word of God together on Cross Connection. Welcome to an interactive live study of the Word of God. I'm Oleg Kostyuk, host of Cross Connection. Thank you for joining me today, joining us today rather. I would like to thank all of you who sent me emails and are involved in our ongoing conversation about the life of Jesus. And I am very excited about our study together. We are coming to you live. And Sergio Gonzalez is handling our social media, and make sure you participate because we don't want Sergio to be out of work.
That's right. To participate, just go to our website and check out our blog. You can watch a live feed of the show in high def at hopetv.org/crossconnection. Now, we don't want you to just watch us as we have a Bible study. We want you to be a part of it. So pick up your Bible and call us at 1-800-714-CROSS. When calling outside of the U.S., dial 707-200-1075, or just text us at the same number.
Thanks, Sergio. We'll come back to you right a little later in our show. Cool. I would like to encourage you to follow our discussion. So pick up your Bible and definitely download our study guide. You definitely want to get a copy of today's study guide because I spent more than 5 hours preparing it. And it's packed with valuable information. And in order to download it, you need to go to our website, click on the free offers tab and fill out the form and we will email it to you. And if you disagree, email to me and we can continue our conversation. Let me ask you a question. Are you really happy? When was the last time when you experienced real joy? Or what brings you real joy or real happiness? Jesus starts his Sermon on the Mount with a list of blessings. They're also known as the Beatitudes. Today, for many of us, it is just another text in the Bible. But you will be amazed when you see how radical his teachings were. When Jesus spoke these words, he turned the political and social world of the Roman Empire and also of the Jewish religious elite upside down. It is the radical teachings of the most unique teacher. This is the opening of a dramatic and fundamental political and social movement. This is not the movement of the past, but of today as well. It is believed that Jesus preached them only once on a certain mountain. And some people believe that it was preached on the Mount of Beatitudes. And you can see the picture of Beatitudes of the church, which was located there. Of course, there is no archaeological evidence that it happened right there. But it is very likely that Jesus was preaching the same sermon quite a few times. That is why a very similar sermon is recorded in Luke chapter 6, and it is called the Sermon on the Plain. But really, it doesn't matter where it was preached, as long as we understand its real meaning. Now, let me tell you something that you probably didn't know about the Beatitudes. It is generally agreed that there are 8 Beatitudes that are recorded in Matthew chapter 5. Even my Bible highlights only 8 of them. But I want to suggest that there is a missing 9th Beatitude that often gets overlooked. And today, on Cross Connection, we will take a closer look at each of the Beatitudes, and I promise you will be astonished and surprised to learn the true meaning of the Beatitudes and how they can impact our life today. Joining me are Sergio. Elisa and Joseph. Sergio, as always, is joining us, and Joseph is joining us second time. How was the weather today?
Okay, I guess.
Okay, and how was your day?
So far, so good.
Okay, so now it's going to be even better.
Right, yes. This is where it peaks.
Yeah. Absolutely. Today we will discuss something which is extremely important, and our topic today will be not just exciting, but very exciting, because we will be talking about the Beatitudes. Mm. The Beatitudes of Jesus. Sometimes people ask me, some people don't even know what the Beatitudes are. What is the meaning of this word, the Beatitudes? Because right. Nowhere in the New Testament can we find the term. Nowhere. I looked a few times and I checked all the concordances that I had. There is no word, the Beatitudes, in the New Testament. But we will find about it a little later. Now I would like us to take some time and just discover the context of the Beatitudes. Let's open our Bibles, and before we open our Bibles, let us pray. Joseph, will you pray for us?
Sure. Father God, as we open up your word, we pray for your Holy Spirit to give us mm-hmm. wisdom and understanding so we will truly see what the words of Jesus meant and how they are relevant to our lives today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Okay, so where is the Sermon on the Mount recorded? Elisa, do you know where it is recorded? Matthew 5, exactly, Matthew 5. So if we go to Matthew, and if you study with us, please download our guide after our study or follow along. Our goal is to cover the entire gospel according to Matthew in a year. So if you follow our discussion, you will be able to know many more details from the gospel of Matthew. So if we open Matthew 5, I'd like us to open actually it a little bit earlier and just make a preview of what we have studied before. We studied about Jesus being born. We studied the genealogy of Jesus, and mm-hmm. our viewers can go to our website and download our first episode on the genealogy of Jesus. Mm-hmm. Then we studied about the birth of Jesus. Then we studied about his baptism, and now we come to the Beatitudes. Mm-hmm. But there is something amazingly interesting about the gospel according to Matthew and how he portrays Jesus in the gospel according to Matthew. Let me tell you about three main things that you can find just reading the first five chapters in the gospel according to Matthew. First thing, Jesus is presented as the king. Did you notice it? Mm-hmm. Remember from the genealogy? Jesus is presented as the king. And then remember who were the first people who came and welcomed Jesus when he was born? Of course.
The Magi.
The Magi, exactly, the Magi. So they came and brought him presents. Jesus is the king mm-hmm. in the gospel according to Matthew. There is another very interesting and fascinating detail. Jesus in the gospel according to Matthew is presented as the prophet Moses. Mm-hmm. As the prophet Moses. Mm. You may ask why and how can we see it? Right. If you go to Deuteronomy chapter 18, and let us go fast, just go to Deuteronomy chapter 18, and Sergio, as always, will be the first to get there.
You give me a verse and I'll get right
there. Deuteronomy chapter 18 and verse, we can read just one verse, maybe 15.
Okay. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your midst, from your brethren. Him you shall hear.
So the Lord promised something to Moses. Mm-hmm. This is what promised to something. What was the promise?
Prophet.
Prophet. And there is something amazing if you open the very last verse of the book of Deuteronomy. The very last verse of the book of Deuteronomy. And it's chapter 34, verse 11 to 12. Verse 10, actually. We can read verse 10. It says, but since then, can somebody continue? 34, verse 10.
No prophet has risen in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face.
Yes, so there was no prophet like Moses risen in Israel. So when Jesus comes, he repeats the entire journey of Moses. Let me ask you, and let us see how and why. There is, first of all, remember male children were killed in the time of Jesus. Remember?
Mm. Yeah.
What happened when Moses was born? Yeah. What?
All of them were being killed.
Exactly, all of them were killed. Second, remember Jesus was taken to Egypt. Mm. Mm-hmm. Where Moses was when he was a little baby?
Yes.
Egypt. In Egypt. Yeah. Remember, Jesus was taken out of Egypt and he came back to Judea. Remember what Moses did?
He was called out of Egypt to the wilderness.
Exactly. He was called out in the wilderness and he went to the wilderness. Remember, Jesus was tempted in the wilderness after he was baptized. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He crossed the river Jordan just as they crossed the Red Sea, but he was also tempted for 40 days and 40 nights.
And Moses was tried in the wilderness for 40 years.
Exactly, exactly.
Wow.
And let's go further.
And I then never
remember
that.
Remember what happened on the Mount Sinai when Moses was on the Mount Sinai. What happened there?
He gave the law, the Ten Commandments. Yeah.
God gave Moses Ten Commandments.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
And now Moses describes this beautiful picture of Jesus standing on the mountain. And then he was seated on the mountain and delivering what?
A new
commandments.
A new commandments. Mm. This is amazing. Wow. Look at this, because Matthew, he is beautifully describes it, and he wants to say, you know what? When Jesus comes, he is not just the king. He is not even just the prophet. He is greater. He is the culmination of all of those.
Mm. Amazing.
He is great. Okay. Isn't it amazing, Elisa?
Yes. I have no idea about that. That's amazing.
Praise God. Yeah, praise God. So, and this is what the Bible teaches us. Let me ask you one more interesting thing, and then we will go to the Beatitudes, just the introduction. After Jesus was baptized, he was taken into the wilderness, and then he started his ministry. Mm. When he started his ministry, for some reason, he goes to Galilee. Mm. And we can read about it. Let's read Matthew chapter 4. Now we are in Matthew chapter 4, and we can read verse 23. What does it say, Elisa?
And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing all manner of sicknesses and all manner of disease among the people.
Yes. So there is three main things that Jesus started to do in Galilee. What were they?
Healing.
First.
Preaching.
Teaching.
Teaching, yes. Second.
Preaching.
Preaching gospel.
Gospel. And then healing. Third. Healing. So his service, his ministry was holistic. But let me just add one more, because we have just a little time before our break, but I definitely need to share it with you. I want to show you the map of Galilee, not Galilee, Israel. This is the map of Israel, and I hope our viewers will be able to see it as well. So this is Judea. As you see, it's down here, Judea. This is where Jerusalem was. This is where Jesus was apparently baptized, somewhere here, close to Bethany. Mm-hmm. This is where Jesus was baptized. And then for some reason, he doesn't go to Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. He doesn't go to Jerusalem if you go to the Judea, but he goes up through Samaria up to Galilee. Mm-hmm. Then he started his ministry in Capernaum, right by the Sea of Galilee. Mm-hmm. So, and then if we go to the next map, you will see there is a blue line. This blue line is the road. It is the major road, which was called in the time of Jesus, Via Maris. Mm. Via Maris, it was a Latin word. Via Maris means the road of the sea, the road by the sea. And it was the highway, not just the highway. It was the only highway there. Mm-hmm. Just imagine caravans, people going from Damascus and all other places to Egypt. They were going through this road. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And Galilee was situated right there. Capernaum was right there. So when Jesus was preaching, he was preaching to people, all people, not just the Jews, but all people.
Right.
All the way there.
All the way there. And right after the break, we will start talking about the Beatitudes. They're called the Beatitudes, but why? Nowhere in the New Testament can this term be found. And it is commonly believed that the Beatitudes were said by Jesus in the middle of his ministry. Why does Matthew then places them in the beginning of Jesus' ministry? Right after the break, we will have a special guest, Dr. Ernie Bercy, who will help us to answer those questions. Connect with us, share your questions and comments on Facebook and Twitter. We'll see you right after the break. Welcome back to Cross Connection. Do not forget that we are coming to you live right now, and we are looking forward to your participation. Leave us your comments and questions on Facebook, send us a tweet, call us. We will answer live from the studio. We will definitely try to find some time. Let us experience the Word of God together. And Dr. Ernie Bersi is joining us today from the Sunshine State of Florida. Dr. Ernie Bersi, Dr. Bersi, thank you for joining us today.
Yeah.
We are so thrilled.
Good to be here.
We are so thrilled that you can be a part of our conversation, just crossing the borders and crossing the that distance that is between us.
It's a wonderful thing.
That's right. Dr. Bersi, let's begin with the word Beatitudes. The word Beatitudes cannot be found anywhere in the New Testament. Why? What is the meaning of that word, Beatitudes?
It's a Latin word for blessing.
Okay.
The Greek word is makarios, which means blessed. So it's a way of just summarizing what we're looking at. But you're right. They don't describe it. They just do it. Jesus gives blessings. He doesn't say he's going to.
Okay. Dr. Bersi, can you tell us about the meaning of the Greek word makarios? Does it mean if I'm blessed, or what does it mean? Or does it mean that I'm happy, or does it mean that you, congratulations to you? What is the real meaning of the word makarios in Greek?
Well, first of all, we have to remember who gives the blessing.
Okay.
It's God. It's not just a state of mind that psychologically I'm in. It's a blessing from God, and like many blessings from God, it is something we enjoy in part now and enjoy in fullness later on. So there is an element of joy and happiness in the present, but the fullness still is to come.
Okay, so Beatitudes is something that we can enjoy today and something that is to come.
Yes.
Okay, it's a beautiful thought. Thank you. Dr. Bersi, another question. It is commonly believed that the Beatitudes were said by Jesus in the middle of his ministry. But Matthew places them in this context. Why do you think he places them in this context, in the beginning?
Well, first of all, before he gives them, he does let us know that Jesus has been actually preaching for some time.
Mm-hmm.
And so there is a ministry before the Beatitudes, or the Sermon on the Mount. But I do think it's the clue is that if you look closely at Jesus' basic summary message, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, he doesn't want to leave us waiting too long to understand what Jesus meant by repentance and what Jesus meant by the kingdom of heaven. So the Beatitudes provide a way of helping us to know what repentance is like and what the blessings of the kingdom are, and how we can experience that now as we walk with the Lord.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bersi. Dr. Bersi will join us a little later. It's a beautiful thought. Dr. Bersi just said that the Beatitudes is something that Jesus announced already. He said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And we read about it in Matthew 4, chapter 4, verse 17. Mm-hmm. And Beatitudes are about the kingdom of heaven. Mm. Let us go to the core of our message today, the first Beatitude. Sergio, would you like to read the first Beatitude?
Sure, yeah. It reads, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Okay, let me ask you a question. What does it mean? Now it's your time to talk, to tell us what is it mean?
Well, it's interesting that, you know, you mentioned Galilee a little bit, and my understanding is it was a very poor town that he started in.
Mm-hmm.
So it's interesting that Jesus starts with a message to the ostracized, to the poor, and to the peasants, and maybe poor meant something relevant to them.
Mm-hmm.
That they were also poor and didn't have much income. I'm sure it probably means some other things too that Jesus wanted to illustrate, but his messages were very relevant to the people at the time as well.
It is beautiful. His message was to the poor, just regularly poor, or literally poor.
Mm.
But Matthew also says that this message was to the poor in spirit.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
So what is the second meaning of the Beatitude? Elisa?
It means, I think, that they felt little, like someone poor in spirit knows themselves to be small in comparison to the whole world.
Mm-hmm.
They feel their need and that they're not powerful and big. They're they have struggles.
That's right. So just in addition to what Joseph just said, so they were poor, but they also realized their meaningless their need of something greater.
Right.
Yeah. And yeah, if we talk about repentance, remember Jesus' message was Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. It says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has arrived." Mm-hmm. What is the first word of this message? Repent. Yeah. What is the true meaning of repentance?
To make a U-turn.
Exactly. To make a U-turn, to realize that what I lived is wrong. I need to start a new life. Mm-hmm. And I want this today, want to be a revival in our lives.
And it's recognizing that the emptiness that you have, the lack of sufficiency that you have on your own, and that's only, if you don't have that, you can't even, all these things that come later, you can't even bother with that. Yeah. You need that first and foremost.
Okay, first and foremost, what do we need to do to realize that we are?
We need to feel the need. Mm.
Feel the need.
We wouldn't want it.
Mm. Yeah, poor in spirit, that's right.
And I think that's why probably he started in Galilee, because they were in a hopeless situation. Mm-hmm. And you don't appreciate hope until you realize how hopeless you are. Mm-hmm.
Mm. Okay, so let's just realize how hopeless we are.
Yeah. Right.
Okay, how can we relate to our world today? How can we live poor in spirit? What does it mean to realize that we are hopeless?
Mm. And, I mean, to be honest, it goes a lot of these things, not just this one, a lot of these Beatitudes just go directly in contrast to what the world tells us about ourselves, or what we should want for ourselves, what we need for ourselves, you know. Yeah. We're being marketed at 24/7, you know, all these
trust
things that
in yourself,
we should, exactly, things that we need. We
meditate on yourselves.
We're consumers, we buy things for us, and we're all important, and this is completely different.
Paradigm shift.
Right.
Yeah. Here is a paradigm shift. Revolutionize your life. Mm-hmm. Realize that you are poor in spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay, let's go to our second beatitude, shall we?
Okay.
What is the second beatitude? Alyssa, could you read it for us? I heard that it was your favorite beatitude.
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted.
Okay. What does it mean? This is nonsense to me. Blessed or happy or congratulations to you.
Mourning.
Yeah, if you look at the Greek meaning of the word, congratulations to you, those who mourn, because you will be comforted. What does it mean?
It's you read it the first time and it's like, what is this about, you know?
Yeah,
but I think you don't have to be in this world very long to realize that you are going to suffer in this world, that you're experience pain, you're going to experience, there's no avoiding it. So what Christ is saying, blessed are you who mourn, not because mourning is so great and, you know, feeling sad is so great, but because what he says right after, for you will be comforted. You know, God will comfort you.
Okay.
This is connection that's created with God based on our need.
Now let me ask you a practical question. It's in theory it sounds very beautiful, to be honest, and it's in theory the Beatitudes is great. How can we live and realize that?
I think sometimes we see mourning as a weakness. That if someone is upset, straight away we want to make them feel better, and we don't give them time to grieve. We don't give them time to even, you know, King Solomon said, "There's a time to be happy and a time to mourn." Mm-hmm. And Jesus is saying, "Blessed are those that mourn," and so he doesn't want us to see it as a weakness, but the strength comes from him comforting us.
Mm-hmm.
That's where the strength comes from. But many times we try to find comfort from other things.
So first and foremost, blessed are the poor in spirit, and second, blessed are those who mourn, because they will be comforted.
Mm-hmm.
And that's right, Jesus will comfort you. Whatever is in his kingdom will be comforted, and whoever is in his kingdom will be definitely comforted, even today.
Yeah.
Even today. I just remember a beautiful illustration that I constantly think about when I mourn. Mm. And sometimes I cry. My wife can tell you about it. Not just cry, but I'm rebellious. And sometimes I feel in somewhere inside. But there is a stone that I imagine, stone and a chisel. And God just takes layer and layer and layer. It's a painful process, but I guess this is how we become better.
Yeah, and you know that these Beatitudes are all about the kingdom of God.
Mm-hmm.
And again, mourning is when you realize that you need Jesus Christ, that you need that.
Yeah.
You know, and it's only when you're given that harsh reminder of how terrible this world is that you then realize how much you need a different kingdom.
Remember one verse from Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 3? Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 3. It says, Ecclesiastes
7, verse 3. All right,
Elisa?
Sorrow is better than laughter, for by the sadness of the countenance, the heart is made better.
So you see what it says there. The Bible says us, you know what? Sorrow is better. Okay, third beatitude. What does it say in your Bible?
Before we move to the third one,
okay,
I wanted to say something that made a big impact on me. It's one of the reasons why the morning one is my favorite. One time, I'm not sure why, but I started to imagine the children of Israel. Like, the children of Israel always get a bad rap because they wandered around forever.
Yeah, 40 years.
Couldn't learn their lessons.
Killing everybody, and everybody was hated.
But I was just, in my mind, I tried to envision what would have happened to them if they had, you know, smooth sailing, just gone right to the promised land, like, directly. I mean, it might have taken weeks. That's what they say. That
exactly,
it
could have taken weeks.
And just gotten there and been prosperous and had wonderful farms and just everything was going great. And I think down the line, what if that had happened and they had forgotten God? Mm-hmm. And everything was just so easy and they're like, well, we've got it good. We don't really need anything special. We're the chosen people.
That's right.
And then I looked even further than that,
yes,
to the end of time. And all of the children of Israel were there and they come and Jesus says, I don't know you. Mm-hmm. And they said, wait, what do you mean? We're your chosen people. But you didn't take time to know me because you thought you were so great,
yes,
and everything was going well for you and you were successful.
So.
And to me, that would have been 10, I mean, just, I can't even count how many times worse than all the pain that they went through in the wilderness.
That's right.
Come to the end of time and not know God because they didn't know he needed them.
Thank you very much. So going through pain to something which is better, and our heart becomes better. Third beatitude. What does it say in your Bible? Blessed
are the meek, for they will inherit the earth.
So blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth.
What does that even mean?
What does that even mean? We would like to continue our conversation. And we will continue right after the break. We will answer Elisa's question. What on earth does it mean? Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit this earth. Stay with us. Right, we will be back right after the break. Welcome back to Cross Connection, your gateway to a live interactive Bible study. Do not forget that we are coming to you live, so get involved. Before we continue looking at the Beatitude, just write us anything and just post it so that we can see you in being involved in our discussion on the Bible. Okay, let's move to the blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. What does that mean?
I think of meekness as being humble, maybe, and I think sometimes we confuse meekness with weakness. And we say if someone is meek, they're very weak and they just let people walk all over them. But I don't think Jesus was like that. He stood up for truth. He stood up for many principles that were against the grain of society.
Yes.
But we know that he had compassion on people. And so I relate meekness with compassion and maybe feeling with someone that is suffering, going through what they're going through and being able to relate to someone else that is going through such a time as suffering and something like that.
That's right. And it's interesting that just recently there was a research done by Macquarie University in Australia.
Okay. University. Must be real good research.
that was a very good research. And it was actually, we posted even our research on blogs, on our blog, Cross Connection blog. So just if you want to know more about it, go to our website. And that research, John Dixon and Dr. Edwin Judge, they tried to understand what humility is, or meekness, what meekness is. And the study concluded quite clearly that people in the first century looked at the life of Jesus and his shameful death and reasoned to themselves. If the greatest man they knew lived such a humble life and died for others in such a shameful way, then greatness must involve meekness and humility. Because before the first century, people didn't even talk about humility. It was all about power, you're Hercules, you're Zeus, you're somebody else. You need to conquer the world. Alexander the Great, conquer the world, beat Now, meekness comes to the stage. Fourth beatitude.
Right.
Sorry, because we need to go to the fourth beatitude. What is the fourth beatitude?
Let's see. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness.
Yes.
For they shall be filled. Mm.
This is beautiful. What does it mean to you in your life?
You know, we talked about righteousness in a previous program as as someone who pursues the will of God as it's revealed to them. And so I think something, someone who's pursuing righteousness maybe isn't, you know, doing X, Y, and Z, but just is opening up to the will of God in their life and what they should be doing.
Exactly. So how can we apply it in our life? Just open ourselves up? Just like?
You know, I think God reveals himself to us in different ways through prayer.
You have to seek it.
Yeah.
Seek it.
Actively, because the more you seek it, the more you'll want it.
It says hunger and thirst for righteousness.
Mm-hmm. Is it easy for young people to seek and hunger for righteousness? Young people who are just young, just like us.
I don't think it's easy. You know, it's not an easy thing to do, but I think our heart yearns for it, even though we don't realize it. There's something that cannot be filled unless Jesus fills it. You know, C.S. Lewis said there's a vacuum in our hearts, the shape of Jesus. Yeah. And we're all searching for that. And sometimes it takes time to realize that, and we don't realize that after some experiences, but sooner or later we will realize that we need to be filled.
Yeah. Absolutely, absolutely. And it's just coming back to something interesting. Luther, I just recently read a biography of Luther, and he said, he talked about his dog, his name was so-and-so, Topol. His name was Topol, and when he was eating once, he saw this dog looking at his table and striving for this piece of morsel or piece of ham or whatever it was. I don't know what it was, piece of meat. And he said, Luther then wrote later, if I could only pray and I could only seek for righteousness the way the dog looks for at meat.
Right.
All his thoughts are on that morsel or that piece of meat. Right. He thinks, he wishes, he hopes about nothing else. But my heart fails because it cannot hold to righteousness without wandering.
That's really, and you know, it reminds me thinking, why is that dog looking so much for that food? It's because he's
tasted it before.
Yeah, and he has an empty stomach. Poor in stomach.
Yes.
You know what
that's
I mean?
Right.
Like,
yeah.
We need to be poor in spirit. And that's where that hunger and thirst for righteousness comes from.
Mm. Hunger and thirst for righteousness, yes.
Yeah, and I think, you know, the Pharisees thought the totally opposite. They didn't realize they were empty. They were saying, what we do, that will give us the righteousness we need. Mm-hmm. It's something we do, but really Jesus is saying you need to be filled, and we can only really be filled until we're emptied.
Yes, right. Exactly. Yeah. And you will be filled. This is what he promised. Yeah. Hunger and you will be filled.
Yeah.
Yes.
The whole philosophy of that time was turned on its head, because in that time everything was about what you did, not how you were hungry, you know.
Okay.
So Jesus says it's, you know, blessed are they which hunger because they'll be filled. It's not like because that's you right. walk this way or don't do this thing.
That's right, yes.
We have what we're talking about kind of relates to a question that we've been sent in. Julie's asking,
okay,
do we know whether the people Jesus mentioned in the Beatitudes, such as the poor in spirit, those who mourn, etc., will receive their rewards fully on earth, or will these rewards only be received in heaven? We're talking about being, will be filled, you know, is that all now? Is that later? What's the...
Julie, thank you so much for your question. And it's a very good question.
Yeah, yeah.
Because if we read the first Beatitude, it says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven now. Yes? It's present tense. When we continue, it seems like it's future. Yes? For they shall be comforted, for they shall be filled, for they shall be envious, and so on. So, and the last one, the last Beatitude is, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. But what does it really mean? Does it mean that now or later?
Right.
Let us ask our expert, shall we?
Yeah.
Shall we?
Yeah.
Dr. Bercy. Dr. Bercy.
Ah, that's a very interesting point you're making.
Thank you for
being here. You as a Greek student, you know that word is, for theirs is,
yes.
is a big Greek word with five letters.
Exactly.
So Jesus is wanting to emphasize that we do have assurance of the kingdom at the present time.
Yes.
It's got to be understood as not dependent on anything we do, or anything we bring to Jesus except our sense of need. But the fact that some of those are future, we know that the meek do not inherit the earth now. I mean, that's the clue right there, that at least part of these future promises remain to be fulfilled.
Yes.
And even Jesus will say a little later on, pray in the Lord's Prayer, thy kingdom come. So even the kingdom hasn't come now. And so until the kingdom comes, the blessings don't come in their fullness. We have the promise of the kingdom. We have the assurance of the kingdom. We have the presence of the kingdom in Jesus and our relationship with him, but we don't have the full measure of all that the kingdom offers until that prayer is fully answered, thy kingdom come.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bruce. We are so glad that you're part of our conversation as well.
So, thank you.
The kingdom of heaven is something that has come, but not yet.
Yes.
Already, but not yet. So you can experience this joy now, but the greater, the greatest joy, greater joy, you can correct my English, even the greater joy will come later.
Yeah, your need won't be filled on this earth. I mean, to quote from C.S. Lewis again, he said that if I encounter within myself a void that this world can't satisfy, I must conclude that I've been created for another world.
This is beautiful. Thank you. Thank you very much. I must conclude, I was created for a better world. I want you to remember this line. I was created for another world. Okay, let's go to the next beatitude. What is our next beatitude?
Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy.
Okay. Merciful. What is that beatitude about?
Now it's talking about how we treat other people. All these other ones, it seems to be self. You know, we're poor in spirit, we mourn, we are meek, we hunger and thirst. Now it's talking about how we treat other people.
That's right. So it's a progression, we can say. Progression of faith. You go from yourself, work on yourself, and then you go to outer circle. Okay, so what does it really mean to be merciful towards others? And how can you show it, or how can you experience it?
I think part of it is treating others as you would like to be treated, as Jesus said, and showing mercy. It's amazing how much mercy we want to show ourselves or have to ourselves, but when it comes to someone else, we're very, you know, we want things done a different way. So treating others as we would be treated is, I guess, a part of that.
Yeah.
Okay, so we can treat others.
Other-centeredness.
Other-centeredness. Forget about yourself. Just love others. Love others. More. So it's more about maybe compassion and forgiveness. So now we express our compassion. We feel with compassion towards others, and we are forgiving. And that is what the Lord's Prayer later on. And forgive us our sins just as
we forgive.
We forgive others. So if he will not forgive us, because it says, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Okay, the next beatitude. This is a beautiful beatitude.
Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God.
Blessed are the pure in heart.
I'm just going to jump right in. We have another viewer question that didn't give their name, but they're asking, in this specific beatitude, how is it that we shall see God? Does this mean the physical sight of God? What does it actually mean?
Okay, we got another question with no name.
It's a great question.
It's a great question.
What does it mean to see God?
Okay, thank you so much for being part of our conversation. What does it mean to see God? Yes.
Well, I don't think that it means to physically see God, but I think what I gather from it is just as back in with Moses, he couldn't see God because he wasn't pure in heart. But as God recreates our heart, then when we see God, we won't be consumed, you know, because all our sin is what separates us from God. And if we have that cleaned from our hearts, then there's no
separation.
We don't burst into flames.
That's right. In John chapter 1:18, it says, nobody has seen God. In John chapter 1, verse 18. But nevertheless, this is the promise for the future as well. So it means that today we can see God, because if we are pure inside. The heart in Jewish mindset was inside, internal. So if we are pure in heart, we can experience the presence of God in our hearts.
And understand.
And that is why Jesus, when he came, he said, I want to dwell among you. So he wants to dwell in
Jesus
our
hearts. Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father.
You've seen the Father. So through Jesus, I guess, we can see him.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, let's go to next beatitude.
Okay. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God.
Okay.
I think we need peace today. There's so much turmoil around the world. We need more peacemakers. And sometimes it seems in the world we live in, you can't get anywhere if you don't step on someone to get up. You know what I mean? Or you know, you can't have peace unless someone else is suffering or having injustice done to them, because we want so much of society to maybe meet our needs.
Yes.
And so I think this is a message for today, needing peacemakers.
Peacemakers.
Yeah.
You know, we have a question Martha asks on Facebook about this beatitude. She
says,
what does it mean to be a peacemaker? Is it more than just avoiding conflict or wanting world peace? And that's a great question, because it kind of leads... What she's asking is, because what she's describing there is peace lovers. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't say blessed are peace lovers. It says peacemakers.
Peacemakers. Okay, Sergio, I guess, is ready to answer that question. Okay, Sergio is passionate about it. And remember, if you have any questions, post them directly on our website. Call us, text us, or comment on our Facebook page or tweet us. It doesn't matter when you post your question. If we hear from you, we will answer this question. And right after the break, we will come back to Martha's question. Martha, thank you for your question. Welcome back. We just stopped on the question, and Sergio, could you remind us of a question that was asked by Martha?
Yeah, Martha asked, what does it mean to be a peacemaker? Is it more than avoiding conflict or wanting world peace? And then she says, thanks, Pastor Oleg.
Okay.
Throw that in there.
More, is it avoiding the conflict or...
Right.
Or what was the continuation?
Well, you know, is or wanting world peace.
Okay, wanting
which
world
is so
peace.
General, I think, is what she's saying.
Right.
Again, oh, everyone wants world peace,
but
she's saying, is it
peace,
something
pacifism.
That you do in your own life, which I think definitely it is.
Okay. Yeah. So, and I like what Joseph just said. So we are not in peace today, are we? Mm. We are looking for this peace. Even look at the world that we are turning towards Eastern meditation now, because we try to find the peace. We try to reunite among each other.
I think even what Joseph alluded to, just in general in this world, if you want to advance, if you have ambitions, you have to step on other people to get there.
Mm-hmm.
You
know, it's wars.
Right, exactly. So
wars, exactly.
Exactly, yeah.
Look at the most popular movies. It's all about wars now, yeah?
Right,
it's all
right.
About wars. So peacemakers, I'm a married man, and it's creating peace even in your families, or with your girlfriend or with your boyfriend. Or at your workplace, peace. And when Jesus was preaching about it, he was saying, you know what? I want you to be a peacemakers, not just peace lovers.
Right.
Yes.
Peacemakers. And I guess...
So search for practical ways
practical?
To promote peace between... Like, for instance, a soft answer turneth away wrath. That's one way. Yeah. I mean, interpersonally, we can...
Or sometimes if I want to shout on my wife, I say, no, Oleg, you have to create peace. Or sometimes even if I disagree with something, I should, no, it's time for me to calm down and create peace.
Even in other relationships, you can
do
it.
Any
if
relationship.
You see conflict anywhere, instead of going, oh, man, those people should love peace how I love peace, then they'd be a lot happier. No, you should try and intervene in any way you can just to promote peace.
Show your peace,
right.
And peace will be given to you. Yes?
Yep.
Because you will be called sons and daughters of God.
Wow.
Almighty God. This is beautiful. Mm-hmm. If you want to be called the sons and daughters of God, definitely create peace around you. The eighth beatitude, what does it say?
Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Okay. We talked about it in our previous program on John the Baptist. Mm-hmm. John the Baptist was persecuted. Yes?
Yeah.
Wasn't he? For righteousness' sake.
Right.
How can we apply it in today's life? Are we persecuted for righteousness' sake at all?
Depends on what you define as persecution.
Mm. Okay,
where you live. You
know? Okay.
Yeah, it's true.
Okay, just imagine that our country in the United States today. Mm-hmm. Are we being persecuted? Or in Australia? Are we being persecuted today for righteousness' sake?
I think sometimes whenever you stand up for the right or whenever there's instances, even say within a family, between a husband or a wife or children, you can be persecuted even in your own house in terms of wanting to stand up for the right. Mm-hmm. You can be persecuted in your job if you're not given the religious freedom that you need, maybe to take the Sabbath off or something like that. You can be persecuted in that way. So. Persecution takes place. I think there's people even around the world dying for their faith, and that does take place. And maybe we're a bit luckier in some countries where we're more comfortable, but persecution can happen, I think, in every sphere of our life.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
This is so when we talk about persecution, it can happen and it is happening for righteousness' sake. Yeah. But blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Yeah. So we don't have to be afraid of it. Mm-hmm. We just need to be probably prepared.
And I think we should be persecuted for righteousness, not for doing something wrong.
That's right.
Many times we say, well, I'm being persecuted. It must be because I'm doing God's will. Exactly. But we've got to make sure it's according to God's word and persecuted for the right reasons, not for the wrong reasons.
Okay, this is beautiful. Let's go over eight of these Beatitudes. First Beatitude, what was it?
Blessed are the poor in spirit.
Poor in spirit. Second one.
Blessed are they that mourn.
So we are poor in spirit. We realize who we are. Then we go to the second step. We mourn, and we mourn, and blessed are
We'll know the comfort of God in our lives.
And even if we mourn, our heart is being transformed. Mm-hmm. Third.
Meek. Blessed are the meek.
Blessed are the meek. What is the meaning, the takeaway lesson from the...
Other-centeredness. And thinking always of other people because it makes you forget about yourself.
Okay, meekness. So... poor in spirit, mourn, meekness, and we have a caller. I just heard it that we have a caller who has a question about the meekness. Let's just take this phone call, shall we? Okay, David. David is calling us from Florida. Welcome to the show.
Well, thank you, Pastor Oleg. This question that came to my mind was when we got to the attitudes, blessed are the meek, because I was thinking about. That I had the chance, my wife and I had the chance to raise three fantastic daughters, and as they were growing up, we always encouraged them to, you know, to stand up for themselves and to be independent, to stand by their convictions. Mm-hmm. And now they're all grown up and successful, and they're all married to terrific husbands, thank God. My question, though, is how does someone being meek relate to being firm and having strong convictions and standing up to for themselves? Sometimes I think that maybe contradicts itself a little bit.
Thank you very much, David, for your very good question. Very good question. If you think about it, even us today, just imagine if we need to sometimes be firm.
Right.
What does it mean to be meek?
Sometimes I think we want to avoid conflict so bad that we compromise principles in our lives, and we're so hungering for peace, but peace sometimes comes at a cost. Yeah. And so are we willing to make the cost of compromising principles, maybe in our family or in our homes? Maybe you have children and you don't maybe agree with what they're doing, and you say, well, I just want peace in the home, and you compromise maybe the standard or the principle, and parents start to act like children, and children are now the parents. I know my friends are going to kill me for saying that, but that can happen sometimes. And so what cost are we willing to pay for peace, like we said? Mm-hmm. I guess that's a big question, and maybe that's what the viewer is asking.
Yeah. So what is the real reason behind when we are talking about meekness and humiliation, yes?
And we can look at the life of Christ. I mean, Christ was meek, he was gentle.
Yes.
He had an incredibly brutal, violent death. You know, I mean, but he didn't, during that whole process, he didn't go, okay, you know, let's, and back away. You know, he stood very firmly for what he believed.
But even remember when Jesus went into Jerusalem, finally, when he got into Jerusalem, and when he saw what was happening in the temple, what did he do?
Yeah. He took out a lash.
He was very humble when he entered the temple. Was he? Right. What did he do?
Yeah. Flipping over tables,
So when he was probably not meek when it was coming to righteousness' sake.
Because he hungered and thirsted for righteousness.
Yeah, it depends on what you're standing up for.
Exactly, right. Probably. Probably this is the most crucial answer. And let me quote Aristotle, because Aristotle is, he mentioned something on being meek. The one who is meek, he said, in Nicomachean Ethics, he said, the one who is meek is the one who becomes angry on the right grounds, against the right manner of the right moment.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And for the right length of time. So, if you are meek, it means that you can be angry the right moment, the right time, and the right length of time.
You know, this ties into a text message question we got too, which asks, we are taught in this world to be strong, to stick up for ourselves, to fight for our success, but the Beatitudes teach us to be meek. Mm. Is it possible to live this way and still reach success, I'm assuming earthly success.
What do you think?
Yes. What is it, firstly, our definition of success?
Yes.
Is it where God wants us to be, or is it having a certain position or title? Mm-hmm. And I think there's many people that we would define as successful but cannot sleep at night. Mm-hmm. Because they are, you know, they don't have peace of conscience, mm-hmm. you know, because success may be costed so much. So I think going God's way, Jesus' way, the meek way, if he wants us to be in a certain position, he'll get us there. But he wants us to be meek first and humble ourselves before him.
Absolutely. Thank you for this beautiful answer. I guess it's the answer to our question.
Yeah.
Let me tell you, I promised that I would show them the ninth beatitude, everybody. And I promised you to show the ninth beatitude. Mm-hmm. Let us read verses 11 and 12 of the same chapter, Matthew chapter 5, 11 and 12.
Okay, blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you.
Mm-hmm. This is beautiful, and sometimes this beatitude gets overlooked. If we talked about all previous beatitudes, we saw eight of them, but they were relating to our life and to our relationship with God and others. There was not even once Jesus mentioned. In this beatitude, Jesus is mentioned, and he says, blessed are you now, not those, not they, blessed are you who revile you for my sake, when they persecute you for my sake. Mm-hmm. So let me just tell you that all the beatitudes, it's almost impossible to do them on your own and just try to, you know, okay, today I am going to be mourning. And then I will, and as the result, I will be comforted. Or today I will be merciful I will obtain mercy. Or today I will be pure in heart and today I will see God because of this. Mm. Jesus is saying, at the conclusion of the entire Beatitudes passage, he says, you know what, if you're persecuted for my sake, then you will be really, great is your reward, yes? He says, great is your reward in heaven. Yeah. And he says in verse 12, rejoice and be exceedingly happy about you being persecuted.
Right.
It doesn't make sense, but in God's kingdom, it's a beautiful kingdom where there is place for everybody. And every morning when you wake up, I want you to pray this prayer, the Beatitudes, and just pray to God, help me to be all what is described in the Beatitudes, the constitution of heaven. Thank you very much, Sergio. Thank you, Elisa. And thank you very much, Joseph. Thank you, Dr. Bercy, for joining us from Florida. And thank you for your very powerful and very interesting answers and comments.
Thank you.
I would like to remind you of a free offer that we had last week. It was an audio version of book Radical Protection by Dr. Derek Morris. It will help you to discover the peace and protection that God alone can provide. We have extended our time for two more days. In order to get a free audio version, go to our website. Click on free offers and request the audiobook. This book helped me to understand what it means to put on the armor of God. And I know it will help you to find peace in God too. Remember, if you have any questions, post them directly on our website, call us, text us, or comment on our Facebook page, or tweet us. It doesn't matter when you post your question, we want to hear from you. And don't forget that you can download the free Cross Connection app from the Apple Store. There is a number of ways to participate in our Cross Connection discussion. See you right after the break. Jesus was a revolutionary teacher. I can only imagine how his teachings were breaking the common notion of that time. His teachings are revolutionary today too. It is for a very good reason that Matthew begins the teachings of Jesus with the Beatitudes or blessings. They are the constitution of his kingdom. They are not the commandments only. It doesn't mean that if you are the poor in spirit, you will get into heaven. It doesn't mean that if you mourn, you will get into heaven. It doesn't even mean that if you are the peacemaker, you will see God. If we want to become citizens of the kingdom of heaven, we need to understand the ninth beatitude. In the ninth beatitude, loyalty to the person of Jesus is openly introduced. Jesus says, blessed are you when they persecute you. Blessed are you when they say all things against you for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for that is your reward in heaven. The Beatitudes show God's generosity of grace in our world, and if you want to experience real blessing, pray the prayer every morning about the Beatitudes, that they fill your heart. Be blessed, and God bless you.